And reading from verse 14, Genesis 3. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception in pain, and you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And to Adam he said, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree which I command you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake, and toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. The thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for dust you are, to dust you shall return. Right, all the way over in the New Testament of the book of James. James comes just after Hebrews. James chapter 1, verse 16. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. And finally in James chapter 3, just a little bit further, reading from verse 5, even so the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on fire by hell. No, verse 8, but no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. Wouldn't it be wonderful if there was always blessing? How do you like to get up in the morning with joy and peace and love? And nothing goes wrong during the day. Nobody says any nasty things to you. Everybody is kind and nice. And you got everything you ever desired and wanted available to you. Nothing ever gets taken away from you. Oh, it would be wonderful, wouldn't it? But it doesn't happen, does it? No, that is not just not the way life is, unfortunately. It just doesn't seem to work that way. We do not walk continually in blessing. We do not. And yet, God designed us to be walking in blessing. When God created the earth, He made it into a beautiful place. And He looked down on it and He said, it is good. He pronounced every single thing that He had made as good. And He planted this beautiful garden in Eden. And He took the man and the woman that He had created and He put them there in the garden. And He said, enjoy yourselves. Enter into the blessing that I have made and created for you. Adam and Eve had everything their heart could desire. They were living in a garden paradise. There were no pests. There was no harm. There was no danger. And each of them was living with the most beautiful specimen of creation that God had ever made. For the guy, you had the most beautiful woman in the world, all to yourself. For the woman, you had the best looking guy in the world, all to yourself. There was no conflict. There was no strife. There was love. There was harmony, and God came right in there every day to come and visit and to come share in that beautiful blessing and the joy that they were experiencing. But it didn't stay that way, did it? Something went wrong, and something entered which was not blessing. It was a curse. And we're going to look tonight at dealing with curses. We've been speaking up to now about the way of blessing. about how that God has designed blessing for us, about how that He has put that blessing into our spirits through the Holy Spirit and in Christ, and how that He has given us the ability to take those spiritual blessings and to pour them forth and to send forth that spiritual power into the earth to create blessing in our lives. But all around us, that blessing is stifled and it is blocked and it is opposed by that which is the total opposite of blessing, and that is a curse. Tonight I want to look at the curse. I want to look at what a curse is, how it shows itself, how we can deal with it, how we can cause these things to be removed from our life, how we can take away the blockages to our blessing so that our blessing can pour forth, so that we can apply the principles that we've been learning to cause blessing to come into our lives. And as we look at blessing and cursing, we find that there are some basic elements that exist in blessing and cursing. And the same elements exist in each, except the other way around. Blessing consists of, firstly, provision. Bountiful provision. God blessed and He gave everything. Everything that man could ever not only need, but desire. When a person is blessed, they have everything they could ever want or need. Or desire. And then secondly, blessing involved protection. God gave them protection. There was no harmful influence. There was no danger. There was nothing to be afraid of. There was no fear in the Garden of Eden whatsoever. And then harmony. Total peace and harmony. There was no conflict between Adam and Eve. No husband and wife squabbles. There was no fighting between the animals. They didn't even eat each other. The animals were all vegetarian those days. There was no carnivores. There was no conflict. There was no strife. There was peace and there was harmony. There was security and safety and protection and boundless provision. And there was love. Love. The love of God in the hearts of man and the love of God permeating the earth as God came down to walk in the garden in the cool of the day to fellowship with them and to pour His love upon them and to receive from them love in return. A beautiful picture of blessing. We try to create that these days at a very great expense. And people spend a lot of money to go to some paradise island somewhere, to get away from it all, to get away from the rat race, to go to a place where you can be all alone at peace and in harmony with just nature. Somehow trying to recreate that garden paradise. Isn't there just something about being in a beautiful place where there's lovely green vegetation and a lovely river of water bubbling past? There's something about that. We travel miles and miles. We spend a lot of money to be able to get to places like that, to go and spend time just sitting on the banks of the river with the beautiful trees and the shade and the flowers and all the beauty that God's created. Blessing. That's what God designed for us originally. And that's the way God wanted it to be. And He warned Adam and Eve, and He said, you can eat every tree, and you can take of the tree of life, but don't you touch the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because in the day that you do that, you will die. We spoke in our study in soteriology on God's covenants, and we saw how God entered into a covenant with Adam. And we saw that part of what's involved in covenants is a blessing if you keep the covenant and a curse if you violate the covenant. And so what happened is Adam and Eve violated the covenant and they came under the curse. And we read a bit about it there in Genesis chapter 3, about how God spoke a curse on the serpent, and how He spoke a curse on Eve, and how He spoke a curse on Adam, and how the natural creation too was cursed. And what happened? Instead of bountiful provision, there was loss. There was loss. It got stolen from them. They lost what they had. They lost all of that wonderful provision. They lost that peace and harmony. It was all taken away from them. And they had to leave the Garden of Eden. Then they were driven out. They lost the blessing. There was destruction. Destruction as thorns and thistles began to come up. As all sorts of pests and bad things began to take place in creation. And eventually we see that manifesting as Cain kills his brother Abel. Destruction taking place. No more security. No more security. Adam and Eve suddenly want to cover each other up from each other. There is no openness, no security, no feeling of being comfortable and secure anymore. And there's strife. And there's fear. All the elements of a curse. Loss. Destruction. Strife and fear. Now a lot of the curses that came on man started right there, and they came as a result of violation of the covenant. And a violation of that original covenant that God made with man. When man sinned and disobeyed God's covenant, he came under a curse. And that curse was passed down upon the generations of Adam, upon every human descendant of Adam. That curse came upon the earth. And the earth is under a curse. And the scripture speaks about the whole creation groaning and travailing under the bondage of that curse. It is known as the curse of Adam. When we come into this world and we grow up with the curse of Adam, it's all his fault, you know. Now, I suppose we could blame Eve if we really wanted to. These women, they cause problems wherever they are, don't they? Yeah, Adam was to blame. The Adamic curse. And of course, we know that Jesus did something about that. He came to be the last Adam and to reverse that curse. And we're going to look at it as we go on. As we go down through God's dealings with man, we see God bringing man into another covenant, the covenant of law. And on Mount Sinai, God gave the laws to Moses. The Ten Commandments and all the laws and the ordinances that go with it. God entered into a covenant, and there were terms and conditions to the covenant. There were blessings if you kept the covenant. And if you broke the covenant, there were curses. Blessings and curses. Blessings and curses. They had a choice. And if you read Deuteronomy chapter 28, God says to them, if you'll obey my commandments that I give you this day, if you'll do that, then blessed shall you be coming in and going out. Blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. You shall be above only and not be beneath, the head and not the tail. You will lend to many nations and not borrow. You'll have no sickness and disease. All the blessings are there. All the elements of a blessing are returned. I will give you bountiful provision. I will watch over you and protect you from harm. I will cause harmony and peace and unity between you, and you will walk in love. But if you break my commandments and violate this covenant, you're going to lose it all. Destruction will follow you wherever you go. And there will be strife and conflict between you. And your heart will be continually filled with fear. Go and read Deuteronomy 28 and see what I'm talking about. It's all there. It's all there. Violation of the covenant. And that is one of the first causes of a curse. Was violation of God's covenants brought a curse into the earth. It was not God's plan. It was not God's intention for man to walk in a curse. God had designed and created him to walk in a blessing. But man violated God's covenant, and man chose to open the door for Satan to come in and to bring in everything that was not of God. And when Adam yielded to Satan in the Garden of Eden and handed everything over to him, he opened a Pandora's box. which opened the door wide for every demon of hell to come into this world and to bring destruction and strife and curse upon the creation. As time progressed, we see another thing that could cause a curse. We see Noah after the flood, and he had his three sons, and Noah grew a vineyard, and he made a lot of wine, and he got drunk, and his sons came in and saw him lying there all paralytically drunk, and he was lying naked. And the one son came and mocked him and went and told the others about their father. We're told that when Noah rose up afterwards, he cursed the generations of that son. He cursed Canaan. He spoke a curse on him. He said, "You're going to serve your brothers. You're going to work under hard labor." He spoke upon him all the elements of a curse. Noah had that kind of power to speak upon his own sons. And you see the same kind of power being followed along. You see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. Especially you see Jacob. As he comes to get his father's blessing, his brother Esau was the one who was due for it. He was the firstborn. And we see Jacob cheating his brother out of the blessing. And he comes and he tricks his father into thinking that he is Esau. And Jacob speaks a word of blessing on who he thought was Esau. But it wasn't. It was Jacob. And when Esau comes afterwards and he says, "But father, don't you have a blessing left for me?" Isaac says, "Not the same kind of blessing. I've already spoken it forth. I've issued a word against your brother, and he shall be blessed." Do you remember we spoke about the word that goes forth into the earth like the law of the Medes and the Persians, the decree that goes forth through human lips? These patriarchs of old were still walking with God. They still had the power in their spirits. And when they opened their mouths and they spoke forth a decree, they spoke forth blessing. But sometimes they spoke forth cursing. And when Noah cursed Canaan, he cursed his generations. And the generations of Canaan have never walked in the same kind of authority and blessing as their brothers' generations. We see Jacob on his deathbed calling his 12 sons together. And he pronounces something over each one of them. And some of them he says nice things. And other ones he doesn't say such nice things. He spoke blessings on some, and he spoke curses on the other. And the words that he spoke over them came to pass. There was authority and power when his words, when he spoke those words forth. There is power. There is power that a man exercises over another man. And Jesus in Matthew 5 and 24 said, if you come to offer your gift at the altar in prayer, and you remember there that your brother has something against you, just drop your gift right there. Go and make right with your brother first, and then come and offer your gift. Why? Because your brother has the ability to bind you, to speak words against you, and to bring a curse upon you that will prevent God from blessing you. Why? Because God works through the agency of man in the earth. And man has the power to release the forces of God in blessing, but he also has the power to release the forces of evil in a curse. Man has that power in the earth. And especially believers, when they speak using the amplified power that they have in their spirit, when they speak a negative word, let me tell you, it is devastating. And there's plenty of examples in Scripture of that happening. When Ananias and Sapphira came before Peter, and Peter spoke a word to them, they fell down dead. There was a power. There was an authority in the words that were spoken. There is the power to bless and the power to curse. And then there are curses that come by association with another person. Association. When you associate with somebody else, your spirit becomes linked to their spirit. And in 1 Timothy 5 verse 22, Paul says, lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partakers of other men's sins. Keep yourself pure. Don't be a partaker of other men's sins by laying hands on them. What is he talking about? What happens when you lay hands on somebody? You're actually uniting your spirit with that person's spirit. There's an impartation. I don't know how it works. I don't know if it has anything to do with the nerve endings in the hand that somehow link with where your spirit connects with your body, but somehow there's power in your hands. And when you lay your hands on somebody, the power that's in your spirit flows out through your body and through your hands and into that person. And I have found that if I get a person to put their hands on my hands, there comes a union between their spirit and my spirit. And in the Holy Spirit, I can tell what is going on in their spirit. I can sense, I can discern, I can feel what's going on inside of them. There's a link that seems to take place. When you link your spirit with the spirit of another person who is walking in a curse, who is walking in sin, who has given Satan place in their life, you run the danger of coming under a contamination from that person's spirit that affects your spirit. So Paul says, don't do it suddenly. You see, the kind of laying on of hands he was speaking about here was the laying on of hands of identification when you recognized somebody's ministry. When you laid your hands on them and united your heart with them and said, we recognize you and we accept you as one that God has chosen and called. He was speaking about ordination and that sort of thing. We need to be very careful who we are associated with. Because as soon as we associate with people, we make contact with them, we pick up what is in their spirit. How else do we pick up what comes from a person's spirit? How does a person communicate what is in their spirit? Words. Words. When a person speaks words, they send forth into the earth words that are containers holding what was in their spirit. And when a person speaks words, they speak forth the power that's in their spirit. We've seen that. But what if the words that they are speaking forth come from a spirit that is contaminated, that is not yielded to God, that is filled with sin, that is under a curse? Then they speak forth words that contain a curse. You say, but they said such nice things. They spoke so beautifully. They spoke lovingly. They spoke tenderly. They were friendly. I didn't sense any curse there. They weren't saying horrible things. No, they weren't. It didn't make any difference what they said. They could have said, Mary had a little lamb. The words came out of their spirit, and their spirit contaminated the words. Sound way out? Let me tell you, you sit and get into conversation with somebody who is under a curse and you come under the same curse. It's all you need. Hold a conversation and receive their words and open your heart to them in interaction, in conversation. And as you do that, you open your heart to the curses that are in the heart of that person. And sometimes you're not even aware of it. Because their words sounded good. Unless you can discern and detect in the spirit what is coming from them, hey, you could be having poison. And it may taste very nice. It may be sweet. But there could be strychnine in there. There could be cyanide in there. Be very careful when you open your heart in interaction with a person who's not walking in the blessing of the Lord. Of course, by the same token, if you share with somebody who's walking in blessing, you pick up their blessing. You feel inspired. You feel lifted up. You feel charged. You get closer to the Lord. Things start to happen. When a person goes wherever they go, they carriers. Carriers of a blessing or carriers of a curse. Well, how do we know if a person's a carrier of a blessing or they're a carrier of a curse? Watch what follows them. What are the three signs of blessing? What are the three signs of a curse? Do they bring blessing wherever they go? Are people prospered by being associated with them? Are people brought into love and harmony by being associated with them? Do people feel secure as a result of being with them? We discovered something that became a joke until we realized that it was not coincidence. And we found that every time we went into a public place, like a shop, and we would stand in one place for a while, suddenly things would get busy. People would start to gather around us. And before you know it, that end of the shop is all crowded. You'd go and visit somebody, and after you've been sitting chatting with them for a while, you keep getting these interruptions on the phone. And they say, "I can't understand what's happened. Ever since you've arrived here, I just keep getting these phone calls for business. What's going on?" We've learned not to stand in one place for too long. It starts to get too crowded then. You kind of get people all around you. Am I bragging? No. It should be what every believer is walking in. Your blessing starts to just radiate forth. And people start coming into your presence. They start to pick it up. It's like a contagious disease. They start to catch it. The scripture speaks about us giving off a savor of life or death. We give off an aroma. You're like a rose walking about. Or you're a skunk. What are you giving off? Be careful who you associate with. Begin to see whether you are walking in blessing. Or do you find after you've been with that person, suddenly certain things start to go wrong in your life? Blessing starts to wane. You start having financial problems. You start getting ill health. Things start to go wrong. Plans that you set in motion suddenly turn sour. And you can't understand why. And you think back and you begin to realize, hold it. Do you know what? This all started since I met old Joe that I haven't been seen for so many years. We bumped into town the other day and we had a long chat. And you know, ever since then, things have started to go wrong. Be very careful. Be very careful who you associate with. Oh, I'm getting paranoid now, ain't I? No, I'm not. God wants us to walk in blessing. And if a curse is coming into your life instead of blessing, especially if you've been applying the principles that I've been sharing and you've been speaking forth in faith and hope and love, and things start to go wrong in your life, and you've been praying and crying out to the Lord and saying, "Lord, I don't know what's happening here. What is going on? Lord, why aren't you answering my prayers? Lord, why are you not delivering me?" You've come under a curse. That's what's happened. You've picked up a curse from somewhere. And I'm going to cover tonight all the different ways that a curse can come in. And this is one of the strongest ones. Association with people. Interaction in conversation with people whose lives are filled with a curse. And your spirit becomes contaminated because you receive their words into your heart. And the poison comes in with it. There are generational curses. In Exodus chapter 20, when God gave the Ten Commandments to the Israelites, the number one commandment was, "You shall have no other gods before me. You won't worship demons. Because that's all another god is. It's an evil power. And God said to them, I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and on the children's children unto the third and fourth generations. I want to tell you that your spirit is contaminated by what was in the spirit of your mother and father, and what was in the spirit of their mother and father, and what was in the spirit of their mother and father. And if you count that back, that's quite a few people. And if one of those in your third and fourth generations has been involved in worshiping demons, in getting involved in the occult and the New Age and all the occult phenomena, then you have had a contamination passed down to you from them. And it needs to be dealt with. It's like an umbilical cord, a thread that is passed down that needs to be cut. You say, but I'm a Christian now. I've accepted the Lord, and Jesus has come into my life, and the Holy Spirit has come to take up His residence in me, and I'm born again. Yes, you are. But you haven't stopped sinning, have you? Your spirit still has the capability of being contaminated, does it not? And that contamination that was passed down to your spirit needs to be dealt with. It needs to be cut. It needs to be removed once and for all. And it's not a very complicated thing. And I'm going to deal shortly with how we can deal with these curses and remove them. But they are family generation curses. And you can look in families and you can see certain sins and certain weaknesses and certain diseases and all of these things. Oh, they try to tell us it's in your genes. It's not in your genes. It's in your spirit. It's a curse. Yes, well, you know, we've got cancer in our family. That's a curse. Cancer is not in the genes. A curse is a spiritual thing. It's a family generation curse, and you need to break it. Well, in our family, a lot of the people committed suicide. It's a curse. You know, in our family, there's a lot of people that are accident prone, and they keep having bad luck. It's a curse. Watch out for these things. Don't assume anything. It's a family generation curse, and you do not have to accept it. Because God said, after He spoke those words, He said, but I give my blessing upon thousands. You see, the curse can only go four generations, but the blessing of God is boundless. It has no limitation. This family generation blessing. Paul wrote to Timothy and he said, I'm glad of the faith that is in you that used to be in your grandmother, and then it was in your mother, and now I can see it's in you as well. You know what power we have as parents to impart the blessing of God to our children and to our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren? Pass the blessing of God down. Let's get rid of the curse. Let's deal with it. Let's cut it off. And let's pass blessing in its place. But if you're walking under a curse and you don't know where it's coming from and you can't seem to shake it and you look and you see it in your family generations, cut it off. I don't know, even know who my great-grandparents were. I never met them. I don't know what they did. I'm not going to take any chances. I'm going to cut it off anyway, just in case. Every believer should be doing that. We should be cutting off every single link. And you know, we need to cut off links with one another. You need to break links with your parents. Spiritual links. I'm not saying turn your back on them. You need to cut your spirit off from theirs. You need to cut your spirit off from your husband or wife. Yes, God has made you one. But if there's a contamination takes place in the one spirit, it's going to affect you. Your spirit has got to be a separate entity before the Lord. It's got to be your own spirit. It's got to be unique. And it's got to be controlled by God and by God alone, not by another person. You put yourself in subjection to somebody else. You unite your heart and your spirit with them. When a man and woman get divorced, there's a spiritual bond there that most times is not severed. And after they've gone through the divorce and the courts have legally divorced them and they've separated, there's still a unity in their hearts towards each other. And such people go and get involved in a second marriage and a third marriage, and they just can't seem to settle in the next marriage. Because they're still married to the first person. Their spirit is still bound to the first person. It has to be cut off. You have to cut your spirit off from every other human being and unite it with God's Holy Spirit alone. You must not be united with anybody else. Not in that way. Yes, there's communion of spirit. There is sharing, especially in the husband and wife relationship, especially amongst believers in a church where Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in their midst. There's a lovely fellowship in the spirit, and we flow together in one spirit in the Holy Ghost. But then your spirit must be independent and separate and not under the control and influence of another. Otherwise, the enemy knows how to get you. It just gets the other person who's weak. And if you're united with them, he'll get them, and through them, he'll get to you. And it'll get communicated, and you go down spiritually. You can't understand where it's coming from. Cut your spiritual ties. Be very careful of them. Be very, very careful of them. The final thing that brings a curse is objects. Inanimate objects. Straight after God had told the Israelites, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not worship, bow yourself down to worship them. He said, you will not make any graven images. You will not make something out of the materials of this earth. You will not make an object and bow down and worship that. You say, yeah, well, that's pretty primitive, you know. In those days, people would go and bow down to idols. We don't do that anymore today. Oh, do you think those people were so stupid to think that a piece of wood was their God? No! It is not the piece of wood they were bowing down to. It was the spirit that was in that piece of wood. You see, an idol is simply an object that is being used by a spirit to link into this world. Do you remember I said to you earlier in these lessons that only a spirit living in a body made from the materials of this world is able to bring about any influence in this world? Satan and his demon spirits have no authority or power to bring a direct influence in this world until that license is given to them by man. But somehow, it seems that spiritual essence can be contained in the elements of this world. Somehow, a spiritual power can be imparted to and contained within a physical object. And that physical object then becomes a means of communication between the spirit world and the physical world. And via that object, contact is made with that spirit. Now, this doesn't only apply to demon spirits. The scripture tells us that God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. That aprons and cloths that had been laid on Paul's body while the anointing of the Holy Spirit was upon him, those pieces of material were taken and laid on sick people and they were healed. They were laid on people that were demon-possessed and the demons left. There was a spiritual power contained in those objects. It seems strange, but there was a power there. When the Ark of the Covenant was captured by the Philistines and they took it in and put it there in front of their god Dagon, Dagon couldn't stand the power. He fell down on his knees. When that same Ark was taken to the house of Obed-Edom, God blessed the whole household. There was a spirit contained in that object. Strange, strange situation. When Joshua went into the land of Canaan, and after they had conquered Jericho, he warned each one of the soldiers who went in with them, and he said, when we go to plunder that city, you destroy everything. You do not take anything that belongs to these people. These people are demon worshippers. They are contaminated. Don't you touch the cursed things. Scripture calls it the accursed thing. Touch not the accursed thing. And we know of how Achan went and stole a garment and some gold and a couple of things, and he went and hid them under his tent. And as soon as he did that, a curse came into the camp of Israel. And they went out against the small little city of Ai. They should have wiped them out. But as they got there, suddenly fear took hold of them. Where does fear come from? What is fear a sign of? It's a curse. It's a curse. Fear. There was a curse in the camp. It brought them under fear. They could not conquer the enemy. And when God weeded out Achan and his household, his whole family had already become so contaminated by these things being in their home that God ordered that the whole family be destroyed. Destroyed. Do you know why? Because the only way that you can get rid of the contamination in an idol is to destroy it. We're going to look at that shortly as we end this and see how we can deal with these things. Idols. Cursed objects. All of these things bring a curse into our lives. All of these things have the capacity to stifle the blessing of God that we should be walking in as His children. Now, how do we deal with them? How do we remove them? Firstly, you need to recognize the existence of a curse. You need to recognize that a curse is present. And to do that, you simply need to look for the signs of the curse. You simply need to look for the three elements. Have things started to go wrong? Your car breaks down. You keep dropping glasses and crockery and breaking them. Somebody injured themselves, fell and hurt themselves this week. There's bickering and fighting going on in the home. Everybody's getting on one another's nerves. Look for the signs of a curse. Something's wrong. You don't have to get paranoid about it. But when these things start popping up again and again, you need to sit up and take notice and say, hold it. Hold it. What is going on here? That's the second time that's happened this week. What is going on? Look for the signs of a curse. And when you see the signs of the curse, then you need to start finding out where and how that curse entered in. And you need to deal with it. And the first thing you need to look at is, it is me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Where did I blow it? What did I do? Where did I open the door? Did I violate God's command? Did I get involved in something that God forbade? Did I just give in to the temptation to read that horoscope just for fun? Open the door to evil. Deal with the personal sin in your life first. Have I spoken a curse upon myself? Where instead of speaking blessing, instead of speaking the good, I've used my tongue to release the forces into the earth to create the negative. Well, we're never going to get out of this problem. Yeah, I think it's just going to get worse. This pain in my body, oh man, I can just see it's going to get worse. I know it, it's going to get worse. I expect it to. You create the very thing that you're not wanting. You create that very thing. Why? Because you have not walked in faith. You have not walked in obedience to the word. You have not been saying, my God says this. You're not saying, I believe. I'm standing on the word. I believe. Perhaps you're not walking in love. You've allowed bitterness to enter your heart. And you've got angry with somebody. You won't let go of that. They hurt you bad. You won't let go of that. You are blocking the blessing of God in your life. And you're opening the door to the curse. And there's something the Bible calls the law of judgment. Jesus says, judge not that you do not be judged. For with the same measure that you use, it shall be measured back to you again. When your wife starts acting like everything you always hated in your mother. When your wife starts behaving like the arrogant, horrible things you saw in your father. Sit up and take note. Because the judgment that you made on your parents coming back at you. The law of judgment. As you speak forth judgment on another, the scripture says with the same measure that you used, the same degree of judgment that you gave is coming right back at you. And as you place your judgment on others, and as you speak negatively, and you speak curses on them, it's coming right back at you. Be very, very careful. Be very careful. The Lord said, we've got to deal with these things. And if you come to prayer and your brother's got something against you, sort it out. If you got something against your brother, also go and sort it out. And say, well, who should go first? Him or me? Well, if one of you upset the other, you know where you should meet. If he lives down the road and you live down the other end of the road, you should be meeting halfway. Because no matter whose fault it was, both of you are responsible to sort it out. And when each of you sat down in your home and said, okay, it's my fault, I must go sort it out. Now the other person can sit down and say, well, it's his fault. Well, then I must go sort it out. You see, whether it's your fault or his fault, you're responsible to sort it out. It's no excuse. If there's bitterness and conflict and strife and division in the body of Christ, you come under a curse. And that's what Paul was speaking about in the Lord's table. When he said, if we judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But we judge because we eat and drink unworthily, not discerning the Lord's body. Not realizing those other members of the body that I'm in conflict with. I must deal with it. I must put it to sleep. Otherwise, I'm under a curse. Opening the door to evil. Opening the door to strife. Got to shut it off. Breaking of family generations is very simple. You simply need to obey James 4 and verse 7, which says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. It's a case of saying, Father, I submit myself wholly to you now in spirit, soul, and body. Give myself completely to you. And now, Satan, in the name of Jesus, I come against every influence and every family generation link. And every power that you've tried to bring upon me through the sins of my forefathers, and I renounce them, and I have nothing to do with them, and I cut that cord, and I break every link now, and I separate my spirit in Jesus' name. It's that simple. Nothing complicated, but it must be spoken verbally as a declaration in the earth. It must be done with words. Words. Don't sit and pray in your mind. The devil can't hear you. Speak words. Associations. It's impossible to avoid certain people. We meet with people and we rub shoulders with people all the time in the world. But learn to shut your spirit off. And even when you've had to open your heart and your spirit to somebody and you know that they're under a curse, as soon as you leave the presence of that person, just break free. Thank you, Father. Submit myself afresh to you. I just break every spiritual link. I renounce and let go of any curse that I may have picked up from that person, and then speak blessing on them. Shine the light. Lord, I bless them now. Bless them. Take away that curse. Speak blessing on them. Open their eyes. Open their heart. Pour into them what you have instead of receiving from them what they have. And then there's the words of others. Sometimes that you cannot avoid. Sometimes you can feel when people are talking about you. Have you experienced that? You can feel they're talking about us. I just know it. I can just imagine what they're saying. Now, don't you allow bitterness to get in there. All you do is just send their words back. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm protected by the blood. And I neutralize any effect of their words and any negative influence that they send there. I shut my spirit off from it. In Jesus' name. There's no power. There's no curse coming from without that can touch you as long as your spirit is separated unto the Lord. There's no power that can touch you. There's no demon force. There's no spiritualist that can speak words and pray prayers against you and bring curses against you. They do not have the power to do it because you have the greater one living in you. But you get into their camp and you're asking for trouble. You think you can go into a seance and say, I rebuke you in Jesus' name and break it up? I wouldn't dare if I were you. You keep out of the enemy's camp. You don't go and get involved in things that God never led you into. And don't think that you can go and bind the demons in somebody like that because you have authority. Unless the Holy Spirit should lead you to do that in a very definite way. Be very careful. Keep your spirit free and uncontaminated. Keep it separated unto the Lord. And watch out for cursed objects. There's two kinds of cursed objects. The one is an object that is made specifically to be an idol. The most obvious one is the St. Christopher that people wear around their necks for protection. One that's not so obvious and fools a lot of Christians is a golden cross or a wooden cross. We don't worship the cross, we worship Jesus. And he's not on the cross anymore. You wear a cross and you begin to see that cross as an emblem of blessing. Be very careful. You don't even know where that cross came from. A lot of those crosses have been specially blessed and impregnated with evil. And you wear this cross that you bought in the shop. You don't know who made that cross. Crosses have been known to have satanic emblems embedded in them and then overlaid with gold so you can't see it. There's hexapoints. The Star of David type emblem. There's the pentagram which the spiritualists use. Watch out. These are idols. Watch out for little carved images made by natives and people that are involved in witchcraft and demon worship. Maybe you went to Africa and bought one of these beautiful little carved things made by the African people. It is so beautiful. And you brought it home again. You brought an idol. It was made for worship of a demon. Be very careful. Be very careful of any object. There's obvious objects like the Virgin Mary and the Buddha that are made to be idols. When something is made to be an idol, there's only one way that you can take that power out of it, and that's to destroy it, to burn it. And there's so many other things. There's books that are contaminated. Books contain words from people, and words are impregnated with what was in their spirit. Be careful about bringing worldly magazines into your house. You say, but it's only innocent articles in it. There's nothing bad. There's no horoscopes. Yes, but what about the person who wrote it? What was in their heart when they wrote it? Could be a contamination. Be very careful. Don't bring the newspaper into your house. If you bring it in, read it, and throw it away. It is filled with evil. It is filled with words reporting evil, telling about what Satan is doing in the world. It is filled with words that create fear. Just get the news headlines and shut it out. By all means, keep up to date with what's going on in the world, but don't keep it in your home. It's an idol. It must be destroyed. And then there's idols that are not idols because they're made to be idols, but they are idols that have simply are objects that have become contaminated by being in the presence of somebody who's under a curse. This could be an idol. If this microphone had been used by somebody who was under a curse and under a demon influence, their presence could actually contaminate this object so that when I pick it up later, it's still there. It's the same thing as the cloth that we're on Paul. We're impregnated with the power of the Holy Spirit. When people are filled with the power of evil, the objects that are on their bodies become contaminated in the same way. But we don't have to destroy those like they had to do in old times, because we have authority now in the name of Jesus. You see, even this Bible could have become contaminated. The paper itself could have become impregnated with evil. Though the words in it are the words of God, the paper, the materials could have become contaminated. And all I need to do is to pray over this object and to decontaminate it and speak blessing on it instead. All I need to do is to hold it up and say, Father, I just cause this object to be transmuted out of darkness and into light. I take it out of the kingdom of darkness and I shine the light on it and I speak blessing on it now and your anointing upon it instead. We remove that contamination from it. Paranoid? Do you think? No. When you walk in the gift of the discerning of spirits and you can sense the presence of evil, you can walk into a room and you can feel that there is an object in that room that is bringing a sense of evil into the room. Most other people are not aware of it. It will stay there and it will keep putting forth its influence. It will keep blocking and blocking the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. And you keep trying to walk in blessing. And you know what you're like? You're like a motorboat that's in the water. And you've got your engines going at full speed. And you've put the throttle right up. But there's a rope tying the boat to the bank. And you're going nowhere. Cut the cord. And suddenly the boat just takes off. And you can't understand what it was that was holding you back before. Break the curse. Deal with each one of these things in your life. And then just take those principles of releasing the blessing of God. And suddenly you'll start to take off. Like a plane that is gathering speed on the runway, just gaining momentum, going faster and faster. Suddenly things will start to happen in your life. Suddenly blessing will come forth that you've never known or experienced before. And all it took was just to cut some of those cords, cut some of those family umbilical cords, some of those generational links, some of those associations, all of these things that are blocking God's power in your life. Just cut them off. Neutralize them. Speak against them. Counteract them with blessing. Blessing. The scripture says we should bless and not curse. We should speak blessing all the time. And as we speak blessing all the time, the curses are neutralized. As we renounce and break and disassociate ourselves with all of these things, the curse is removed. The scripture says Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon us. God wants us to walk in blessing. Jesus has redeemed us from the curse. Let's no longer walk in curse, but let's walk in blessing and in blessing alone. Amen.